Hi folks, so I lead the delivery engineering team in Swiggy, and my perspective here is going to be from the consumer side of data. I'm responsible for ensuring that the delivery operations are both efficient as well as predictable in Swiggy, and so this talk is more about how in logistics, especially real-time logistics, we are using data. And not just data science and data engineering, but general focus on data. You know, how is it relevant for us to take decisions on, you know, capacity and efficiency. So, I have a little sore throat, so please bear with me on that. I'll talk a little bit about the introduction to the capacity and the efficiency problems. Then the challenges with respect to data capture, the inherent nature of data. Then we'll run through some efficiency levers that are very important to us. And then we'll talk about what we have done in simulation and in running experiments in the real world. So firstly, a quick snapshot of what delivery actually involves, right? So there are two parallel tracks here. You know, on the top you see is the preparation time track. Once the order is obtained by Swiggy, the restaurant gets the order and the restaurant starts preparing the order. On the other hand, we also start searching for a DE. A DE is short for delivery executive. We search for a delivery executive, we find the best one, we assign the order to him or her, and then the delivery executive travels to the restaurant, which is called the first mile time. If the delivery executive has reached before the food is ready, then the executive ends up waiting there. And if the delivery executive reaches after the food is ready, then the during this time, the food was waiting. Both of these are bad options for us. But in any case, the pickup is done once both are ready, and then the last mile happens. Now, just to be clear, last mile is not just you know, reaching the customer's doorstep. It also involves navigating through the society in which the customer is in or the office building, and actually delivering and handing over the food packet to the end customer. So the first problem is capacity. You know, in very short and simple terms, capacity is about how many orders should I accept, right? So given I have 100 DEs, let's say, you know, what is the number of orders I should accept? In other words, at what point should I start saying, no, I'm not going to take any more orders from the customers? This is the high level problem. Now, given 100 DEs, I can deliver, you know, 300 orders given enough time. Right, so the first constraint is obviously you don't want to serve orders, you know, 2 hours down the line to customers. So the first constraint is there is a max SLA. I don't want to serve orders beyond this particular time. now, obviously, the second important thing we've already pointed out is how many delivery executives do I have at any given point in time. So that determines, you know, that's a base level determination. So if I have 100 Ds, what's the minimum number of orders can I serve? Obviously 100, you have to do better than 100 because you have 100 delivery executives. Now, beyond 100, lot of factors start affecting, you know, how many orders we can actually serve in the max SLA time. So there are things like, you know, what is the traffic conditions on the road? If the traffic is less, then my each of my delivery executive is actually delivering orders faster, coming back and then taking up the next order and delivering, right? So now you can deliver probably not 100, but maybe 120, 150, maybe 170, or maybe even more. So what determines this? One factor is traffic, weather and all are conditions that may happen, may not happen. You know, customer density, how close are customers to each other, and also customers to restaurant distances, right? So, and distances is actually a proxy for time. You may, in Bangalore, for example, 1 kilometer could take you half an hour to travel, right? Depending on traffic conditions and all. So all of these factors in conjunction determine what is the true capacity that I have, the same number of Ds. Now let's say you have 100 Ds still and all of these things remaining the same. Let's say you yesterday you delivered, you know, let's say 140 orders. Then with the same number, 100 deliveries, with everything else remaining the same, imagine that traffic conditions are the same, or number of orders that you have got from the customers are the same, can you still deliver 140 orders, you know, given that you have 100 Ds? may not be necessary, right? Because 100 delivery executives at 7 p.m. in the night is very different situation from 100 delivery executives at 10-15 p.m. in the night. Because these many of these hundreds are going to log off in the next maybe 15 minutes, whereas at 7 p.m. more are going to join the fleet, right? So your true capacity at is not just dependent on these factors, number of Ds and all. It's also dependent on what is going to happen, what is predicted to happen in the next n minutes, right? So now you see the nature of the problem is such that a lot of external factors are coming in into play. Right, things like traffic, weather conditions, there's an accident on the road, there's a road construction going on, multiple things which are not predictable control what is our capacity, right? Another example given here is batching possibility, right? You can also take the same delivery executive and give him more than one orders as long as the customers are nearby and multiple other conditions are satisfied. So the capacity problem is more about how close to actual capacity can I get. We don't know what the real capacity is. It's very hard to determine that. So it's more of and what are the costs, right? So suppose I over predict my capacity, which means I end up taking more orders than what I should have taken. What ends up happening is that customers will now get orders delayed, right? So they'll have a bad experience. And if I under predict my capacity, then I would have left orders and money and hence money on the table, right? So both of these conditions are not true, and hence it's very important to operate at the true capacity level. Now capacity has two notions here. One is the more common form, which is the aggregated capacity. We calculate it at zone level. In some sense, it is a ratio of how many orders we have with respect to how many deliveries executives we have. Now the traditional notion of capacity, this is the stress in the system. How many orders can we take is an upper bound, right? That bound is traditionally calculated by a lot of learning that happens in a very static and human learning mechanism. That used to be the traditional way of computing capacity, and the way it would still work is because given enough number of days, enough experience of people who are running on-ground operations, it used to kind of be okay sometimes. But that's no longer going to scale. It is not responsive to sudden changes in conditions on the road. It's not responsive to weather conditions because rain happens once a while, and when it happens, you don't know what the intensity is and so on, right? So what is the right number where you would stop accepting more orders? So this is one of the challenges, and often what it also leads to is that if I have an incentive as an operations person to get to serve maximum number of orders, I may tweak these numbers without any scientific reasoning, and that could also lead to bad orders and customer dissatisfaction and so on. So we worked through this problem for quite some time, tried various algorithms, came up with different statistical modelings. As I said, I am from the delivery engineering team, so I work very closely with the data engineering, data science teams and all. Ultimately, the current version that we are working with is called order limiter. It is very, very much dependent on what is happening in real time on the ground, right? What state the delivery executives are and where are they in real time? How close are they to their destination? What is happening to the food that is being prepared on the restaurant? Was the last signal that we got in time as predicted, or was it delayed by 10 minutes or delayed, or was it early by X minutes? So all of these conditions are taken into account. Things like when will the delivery executive get free is included in the computations, and we now have a much more dynamic version of capacity. So remember, this is not stress. Stress is still the old notion of saying, hey, how many orders I have with respect to how many delivery executives are there. This is more of what is my upper bound. So this kind of a system, as you can see, is very, very, dependent on what was my ETA, what was my SLA, what was my ETA, what is the current state of each and every order, each and every delivery executive in real time on the ground. So a huge amount of data processing work is required here. What it helps us do is it helps us reduce those bad orders that we would have taken, and it also helps us avoid any orders left on the table. Now, this is a visual representation of you know, how the system works. On the left side, you would see for every you know, n minutes of interval, we would have computed how many orders we can take in that n minute of interval, and the green graph basically shows how many we actually ended up taking. So as you can see, around lunchtime, we are operating very close to what we could have taken, and as the lunchtime you know, fades away around 2 o'clock or so, you see the gap between the blue and the green graph increases. That indicates that our capacity is unutilized at that time, because the orders have got delivered, but the delivery executors are still available. They're saying, yeah, we are still in the system. Equivalent graph on the right side, if you notice, you know, the points here and here, these are places where we have hit the capacity. And so at that point, we would have said, hey, take no more orders. And the yellow line and the blue line here are dynamically changing, right? So that is saying not just what the current capacity is, it's saying, hey, at this point I can take so many orders because, let's say, all my delivery executors are busy, or at this point I can take so many because now they're getting freed up in the next 10 minutes. The other notion of capacity is point capacity, right? Can I accept this order? And this is also very important because, you know, for example, if you have only five, let's say, delivery executives at a particular point in day, a particular time point in time, right? These delivery executives could be in the east side of the society, because most of the times, you know, breakfast, early morning breakfast orders come from a certain restaurants, and on another side of the city, probably there are none, right? So while these five are there, I cannot take five orders from the west side of the city because it will take too much time for these delivery executives to travel, right? So this is an extreme example, but it happens all the time, where we say, ki for this particular order, you know, let us compute, are there any delivery executives available in the vicinity either now or are expected to get freed in the next n minutes. So both of these notion of capacity, as you can see, are fast computations. They're approximate. You can't afford to get all the data in the world, so you kind of do all these computations based on some last known state, and ultimately aimed at preventing both the sides of the spectrum, bad orders on one side and the leaving money on the table on the other side. The other notion is efficiency. In simplistic terms, efficiency is how many orders you know, per delivery executive per hour do I do, right? So there are two notions of efficiency. One is called the assigned efficiency and the other is called simply efficiency. The regular notion of efficiency also includes what is the utilization of my fleet, right? So if you leave that out, in most of the conversation, we'll only focus on assigned efficiency part today. Now, what are my efficiency levers? How do I control that? So first is, obviously, who do I assign this order to, right? So I want to assign, a greedy approach could simply say, hey, I want to assign this to the nearest delivery executive possible. But the problem is that for this order, the nearest delivery executive could have been the best executive for another order, right, which is probably closer than this delivery executive is closer to this order, right? So now we are talking about not doing a greedy approach, but doing a more of a global optimization. So there are, you know, versions of Hungarian algorithms that we have coded up. I'm not going to get into that because the focus here is not the assignment algorithm, but the focus is what is the basis that we use to do these kind of optimization, right? All of these, the basis is, okay, I know where the delivery executive is. I can estimate the time that this person will take to travel. I also have nuances to say that, you know, there are possibilities that this guy may even reject the order. He may say that, hey, I don't want to do this order. We allow, you know, for to certain extent, we do allow this behavior because delivery executives may have certain preference. They may not want to go in certain area, or they may not want to, maybe it's very late, they were just planning to log off from the system when an order came. So rather than accepting that order, they would reject the order. There can be various such situations. So now we are talking about building in those possibilities into our prediction algorithms, building in those possibilities into our predictions of you know, how much time would it take to travel to the restaurant and so on. The other lever is when to assign, right? So for example, if I have to serve an order and I see a delivery executive that is 1 kilometer away, I have a choice of assigning this order to that executive right now, or I have a choice to basically wait for some time and see, hey, is there going to be another delivery executive who may become available, which is closer than 1 kilometer to this order, right? So time dimension is another lever I have. Can I batch orders? We talked briefly about batching. What enables batching is that, you know, the customers, two customers or three customers who I'm going to deliver the order to have to be close enough. And the orders have to be close enough in terms of both the source, which is the restaurants, and the destinations, which is the customers, and also in the time dimension. You don't want to, batch two orders if they have come 20 minutes apart. You want to batch two orders if they were close in time dimension as well. Now, obviously, the reason why this is important is, can I predict whether a specific order is capable of getting batched with another order given all these constraints, right? So again, you're talking about, looking at a lot of data, learning from the past and taking real-time input. So for example, if there was an order in the system already, 5 minutes back that came in, which satisfies all these three criteria for the order that is coming now, I need to be able to make that decision. Yes, there is an order which potentially, with a lot of certainty can be batched, right? So now when I, it is important not just to predict this batching because you want to know what the capacity and efficiency of the system is going to be like, but also because you want to promise an SLA to the customer. Right now, imagine that there's no such order which is already there, which is waiting to be paired. Then you basically ask the question, ke, hey, what is the chance that in the next 10 minutes, in the next 15 minutes, you will get another order which will satisfy these three conditions, right? So in both, so these two conditions are called second order batching and the first order batching. And in both the cases, we again do a lot of, data analysis, both, real time as well as building data science models to learn these behaviors. The other levers, we talked about those different legs of the journey, order to assign time, first mile time, last mile time, preparation time, customer to customer distance, batching probability. Each of these are data science models for predictions, and each of these have specific error into them. I'll talk a little bit about errors as we go along. The important thing is that all of these models work in unison for us to be able to promise an SLA to the customer. And as you know, errors in these models add up. The second important thing also is that some of these models are used for internal efficiency and internal predictions, right? And some of these models are used to make a promise to the customer. So we also end up doing like different models sometimes to optimize our systems and to make a promise to the customers. The other way we look at data in Swiggy also, especially in the delivery team, is also with respect to trade-offs. For example, if I want to make my efficiency very high, I would want to batch orders together. Now, when I batch two orders, I give it to a single guy, there might be another delivery executive who is waiting for an order but gets none, right? So this is a trade-off between what is the experience that I give to my most important resource, which is in this case the delivery executive. You may end up giving them suboptimal experience and they may end up leaving our platform, right? So if I make my operations very efficient, I may compromise on the experience that I give. I mean, they are here to earn money and we are impacting their earning capacity. Similarly, it could also be that if I batch two orders together, one of the orders that came in earlier could possibly have been delivered first, right? So that order is made to wait because there's a second order that we are possibly going to batch it with. So there's a trade-off there. The first customer probably is getting the order in the promised time, but lesser or it takes more time than what it could have possibly taken. So there's a trade-off right there. Similarly, when I want to make an assignment, so I want to find the most optimal combination of orders with the delivery executive. Now, while I find the most optimal combination, I may end up starving some orders, right? So some of the orders may not never fit in into the, let's say I have only 50 delivery executives, and every time I'm, especially in peak times this happens, every time I have like enough number of orders and less number of Ds compared to the number of orders. And if I keep super optimizing myself, those orders that are, let us say, away from where the delivery executive density is, may end up getting starved. So I can't let that happen, because for those few customers whose orders are starving, the experience will be very bad. So these trade-offs are very important in every decision we make. There's an efficiency versus speed trade-off, right? We talked about it. When I batch two orders, one of the orders at least, sees larger delivery time. Similarly, there is a speed versus compliance trade-off, right? So especially in prediction models, when we build our models, I'll talk a little bit about why there is natural variance in the data, and no matter what model we build, there is going to be a noticeable amount of error, and we have a choice to train our model in either a way that for most customers we deliver within the promised time, or we have a choice to optimize our models in a way where we are as close to reality as possible, but probably in the extremes it will still break, right? So those choices again are very important. So when we are doing so, now that we know capacity, efficiency, has each of these problems, while have their own logistics challenges, they have heavy dependency on the way we use data, whether it's for predictions, whether it is for real-time processing, or whether it is even for debugging and understanding what is happening in the system. So what are the challenges? One is obviously the location capture accuracy. It's a very common problem in logistics, where because of accuracies of the devices, signal presence versus absence, battery drain considerations and all, location accuracies itself are not very optimal. So one of the problems we work consistently on that is that. Then customer locations and restaurant locations themselves, while we do everything we can to make sure that they're accurate, there are instances where both customer either has not entered the right location, or in case of restaurants also, for some reason or the other, will see that their lat longs are not precisely at the area where they're actually located. And even a slight deviation in these locations could have implications on how we are predicting our models. So all of these logistics space, right? It's not just in Swiggy, but one thing that is very important in the logistics space is the accuracy of data, right? Everything else being right, just the nature of capturing a lot of this data from physical human beings is that they are all driven by their own motivations. Right, so unless we incentivize each of these data input points appropriately, we are bound to get signals that are explicit but not accurate, right? And one of the things that we focus on very highly on is how accurate is our data, because if you don't fix that right now, then our models also learn from wrong inputs, and that's a error that you don't want to be there in the model. So an example of DE behavior is that, yes, obviously he may want to save the battery and so doesn't update the location. But could also be that, the DE expects his food to be prioritized by the restaurant if he sends the signal that he has arrived at the restaurant, although physically he may not have arrived, right? So that in his understanding, makes his food get prioritized in the restaurant stack, and so his order will get prepared faster, and so he'll be very efficient. On the other hand, this is how the human dynamics works, right? Restaurants are smart people themselves, so they know some DEs are doing this, or maybe many DEs are doing this. They also have this thing that they have offline presence, right? There are customers sitting physically on their tables. They are also getting orders from outside of Swiggy, right, whether it is offline or whether it is our online competitors. We don't have access to that data. Restaurants are optimizing for those orders as well, right? So restaurants have an incentive in some cases, especially during peak time, to wait until the delivery boy shows up. Now you see it's a chicken and egg problem, right? The delivery executive is saying, I have already reached, when he has actually not reached. And the restaurant is basically waiting for him to come and then say, okay, only then I'll start preparing food, because then it is guaranteed. All of these are, you know, things that cause incorrect data input into the system. This is an example. So this is plotted on Kepler.gl, and what we do is we instrument each of the data points, you know, where a certain event happened, what time it happened, and so on. So this is an output of that. You see the white dot here is a restaurant. Obviously, this is in some percentage cases of our restaurant, not all, but where it happens really badly. The these are the pickup events, where have the delivery boys marked the food as picked up, right? So those are the lat long around there, and the white dot is where our you know, offline method of gathering restaurant location. When you onboard a restaurant, you basically get their name, address, and blah blah, and we also get the lat long there. So this kind of an analysis clearly shows that there are restaurants in our systems which are off from the actual location. So we do this analysis at scale and then figure out what are the restaurants that are, you know, greater than X meters away from there, from the centroid of the picked up locations. And that's how we go and fix proactively the restaurant locations. This is another example which is again done on Kepler, which shows the D behavior, right? We were always aware that, you know, some of our Ds, they mark their arrived locations away from the restaurant, but the white dots here are indicating, so the denser regions there are the actual restaurant locations, and the cloud of pings that you see around those denser locations are where many of the Ds have ended up marking the reached location, right? So while we were always aware through you know, plain statistics, you know, saying that hey, X percentage of our D marked locations for arrived, you know, are potentially a geo breached condition. But when you visualize it in this format, it looks very clear. It is very clear that the problem, when the problem happens, it can be pretty bad, you know, because some of these locations could be as far as away as 1 or even 2 kilometers away from the actual restaurant locations. So, what do we do about it? We have a lot of product and tech interventions. We have done things like automated detection of location, geofencing, input verification. So if the D is saying I have reached, have you actually reached? Can you look at the restaurant? Can you look at the restaurant lat long and the current location and actually judge whether you have reached? Now you have to do this even in the absence of a very strong GPS signal sometimes, right? Which is when you make the decision based on, again, data analysis. What is the probability that he's telling the truth? You can't block a D because you know that location inaccuracies are there. I could be standing here and my location could be showing off on the other side of the road. It's very possible, very much possible, you know, few tens of meters of granularity, sometimes even 100 meters is there. You can't tell a D that, hey, you know, you're lying and I will not allow you to mark reach, especially if he has actually reached. So you have to accommodate for those errors, and there's a lot of data processing and error handling that happens to probabilistically judge whether the D has actually reached the location or not. And then obviously we have some operational interventions. These two graphs are, you know, our last mile and last mile times and O2D, order to deliver time. You can see the variance is what I'm trying to highlight here. The data is pretty much, you know, highly variant. It's spread across the x-axis. The numbers on the bottom are hidden. This is not necessarily, you know, a sample from all zones. It's from a sample zone where the variance is very high. But the variance itself is something that is inherently there in the system, right? So the idea is that, as I told earlier, there are so many external factors that are affecting variance, and not each of these external factors are possibly captured by any data science model because you don't have data for it, right? You can develop the best models, even the best model will have some errors, but here there is so much natural variance that even your best model will have errors. So what do you do about it? Obviously, this limits our prediction accuracy. The way out of this is not necessarily, while we do chase accuracies, but you can't not do anything about it, you know, and one of the things that we have tried doing is to proactively account for the inaccuracies, right? So any decision you take, for example, you want to decide when to assign or which D to assign, if your accuracy in prediction is, let's say, 2 minutes, right? And if two D's are 1.5 minutes apart, then making a choice between them is not going to make a major difference, right? There's one way in which we can use. Although in practice, we actually assume that when such a decision is to be made, we actually assume the best possible choice there. And then identify the sources of high variance. So it could be load on restaurants, it could be the DE behavior, it could be the stress on the system currently. And there could be many hyperlocal scenarios like a traffic jam in a certain place and so on. So the goal here is that some data like how many tables of that restaurant are occupied as of now is not something we'll have or will probably ever have. But you know, other things like how many of Swiggy orders are there, what is the menu of each of those items, right? Is it ice creams, is it biryanis, is it rotis, lot of rotis? Each of these food items have different characteristics of preparation, right? So multiple of those inputs are used to increase the prediction accuracies. So next I come to, now that we have so many algorithms and so many data focused decisions that we take, how do we actually verify whether what we are doing, let's say you want to do a change in the system, how do we verify whether it's actually functioning or not? So we start with a hypothesis. We go on saying that, hey, if we do algorithm 1 versus algorithm 2, here is what are the metrics that are expected to increase, decrease, move favorably, move unfavorably, and so on. And these are the metrics that are my guardrails, right? I don't want to go bad on NPS. I don't want to go bad on, let's say, my order to deliver time for some cases and so on. So you fix these hypotheses. Then you run the solution. You do the debugging and implementation and everything. And very importantly, do a lot of instrumentation, right? So every single aspect that is possibly could be affected by the changes that you're making needs to be captured. Then we do a very important thing called simulation, right? So simulation is what is happening in the real world. Can I make this happen in software? Can I simulate delivery executive movements? Can I simulate the order rates? Can I also simulate which areas the orders are coming from? Can I simulate the behavior that delivery executives do? Like, for example, at certain rate, I will reject X percent of my orders at certain points in time. I'm going to log off at a certain point in a day at so and so rate. Right, so these are different variables that your simulation environment can do. So run this change through the simulation environment, and one of the most important things here we have learned is it's a kind of a challenge to keep your main code and the simulation code in sync. So as much as possible, we try and do this together. Then we do a shadow mode execution, right? Because each of these logistics experiments are something that you have human beings who are running, right? They are taking these decisions. So it's very hard to, just run simulations and say, okay, what's the result going to be like? Mostly simulation gives directional trends. If I do X, this metric will improve in the range of Z to P percent, right? It may not tell us that this will be the precise improvement in the metric when you actually run it on the ground. So you start running it in shadow mode, where shadow mode may you're actually getting real life data, but people who are using the systems, they don't see the effect. So you're not influencing anything on the ground, but you're gathering enough data to do analysis both real time as well as offline. And then finally, you run on-ground experiments, right? So simulation and on-ground experiments are something that I'm going to talk a little bit about more. And then finally, when the on-ground experiments are successful, then we roll out. Now, before we get into the next slide, I have a small video. I'll just show a snapshot of it. So this is how our simulation runs. This is a visual representation. All the green markers there are the delivery executives who are free. All the red ones are those where the orders are assigned, and you see those red lines shortening is where the delivery executives are moving towards their destinations. And the blue ones are where the delivery executives are moving towards the restaurants. So this is how we run simulation, and when the simulation on the top right, left corner, you will see this is a certain zone. There are so many D's who are free at any given point in time. There are so many the ratio there is representing what is the stress on the system, and the other counts are how many free days and busy days and all we have. So this kind of a system actually gives us directional results on if I take a certain algorithmic decision, then what is my likely output going to be like. Now once, so this is, so this graph actually represents what is our, results on simulation versus actuals, right? So you can see the blue and the red line. The red line is the actuals and the blue line is the simulation results. You can see they are not completely on top of each other. They are not like duplicating each other, but the trends are very much the same. Similarly, here is the histogram. The red one is the actual and the blue is the simulation. Again, you see the same observation that to a very good extent, we have been able to simulate what is happening on the ground, right? Now, the last part is, how do you run on-ground experiments? And on-ground experiments is a huge challenge in logistics because, as I said, too many external factors, too many factors that you don't control. So how do you choose a test set versus a control set is a significant problem. Now, what we have learned is that first strategy was like simple pre-post. We run it, we run without, doing any changes for X number of days, then we run it with the changes and then we observe the differences. This strategy typically works well if you have significant impact on parameters and if you have eliminated any large variable changes. Like if IPL match happens, there's the number of orders like increases drastically. Or if a festival is there, the number of supply, the delivery executive available decreases drastically. So you eliminate some of those large variables, then this kind of gives okay results, but it has to be observable enough. So it has to make a large impact. The other one that we tried was alternate days. This worked a little better than pre-post because alternate days, the variations is much lesser than it's over a 2-week period. Then the third one is control versus test zone. Can I find a zone which is very similar to the zone in which I'm running experiments? So one zone is control, the other is test. We run it simultaneously for multiple days. In each of these experiments, there is some bias, there is some variance. It's very hard to eliminate each of those. But mostly these are suitable for large variations. Then we have gone into more sophistication. We've tried time slicing. We do a certain strategy for 5 minutes, and the next 5 minutes we change it and so on, or we also do it at higher granularity, 1 hour granularity, and randomized selection of orders, like on certain order we apply one treatment, on certain orders we apply another treatment, excuse me, and then we measure the bias and variances in each of these strategies. The last strategy which also works in a lot is randomized geospatial selections, right? Can I run a strategy in certain geolocation, whereas in a nearby geolocation within the same zone, you run a different strategy. Now, one of the most important thing here is network effects, where if I take a certain decision for one order, is it going to impact another order or not? An example is that if I change my assignment algorithm and if I assign one order to a specific DE, it has actually affected another order for another DE, right? That order now cannot be assigned to another DE, which means the behavior for another DE has changed because that order is never going to be assigned to the other DE. So some of these test and control mechanisms, because of these kind of network effects, you will never be able to apply, right? So in logistics, it's very important to know how do you create the isolations, right? So for example, if I promise one SLA to one set of customers and another SLA to another set of customers, their behavior can be independent. So in this, you can do the order wise split. Right, but if you are doing, if I batched, let's say, two orders, right? Now, if these two orders are batched, they are influencing each other, which means that the second order cannot be batched with the third one in the other set, right? So there are these kind of things that we have to be very careful about. Quick on visualization, when we plot a lot of these points on a library like Kepler.gl. We get a lot of insights that aggregate analysis doesn't give us, right? For example, in this case, you will see that the blue points are where this restaurant at the center, the white dot, is serviceable, whereas the orange and the red points on the externalities, they are not serviceable. You will see some blue dots even on the edge. So that led us to ask this question, okay, why are they there? Why are those red and blue dots very close to each other? In this case, we found that it's because of U-turns and all. In some places, you require a U-turn on a lat long. On the other side of the road, you may not require a U-turn. That makes a difference. This is another example where visual representation gave us a lot of insights. On the extreme right, you will see these are a restaurant chain. Our customers are not doing a great job of choosing which restaurant. Let's say this is a chai point. It's not, but let's say this is. So if I show three options to the customers for chai point, which are all nearby and serviceable, the customer doesn't necessarily make the best choice. He doesn't know that the chai point, this one is, probably only 500 meters away and the other one is 1.5 kilometers away. The overlaps there are showing that, right? So it's very important in logistics to do these kind of visualizations, without which you will only be restricted to aggregates. Quick summary of learning, know the input data very well, the source of variance and account and accommodate for it. Minimize the input accuracy, fix the data as source. Understand the trade-offs, use simulations and the experimentation very rigorously, right? Without this statistical analysis of each of these experiments, it's not possible to do any kind of progress in logistics. Questions?